When I had done the Jesus Christ Superstar album, I had an opportunity to meet Andrew Lloyd Webber and Tim Rice, and actually went to the premiere of the first live performance of Jesus Christ Superstar at St. Peter's Cathedral in New York. As I was working more and more on the album, I got introduced to Robert Stigwood, who was friends, I guess, with Andrew Lloyd Webber. And when the album became a play, a live play, a musical, Robert Stigwood was the guy that was producing it. So he reached out to me because I had done the album and the libretto and all that stuff, and he wanted me to design the program for the show and various merchandising material for the live performance. And that's when it was going on the road, and so I got a chance to work with Robert for, I don't know, 2 or 3 months as a freelance project. It wasn't through the agency that I was working at, it was a freelance project. And that kind of happened as I was moving to Craig Braun. I had just finished leaving the agency that I was at and working on that at the same time, and went to Craig Braun, and then came back out to LA, and we started Pacific Ioneer in 1972. And about a year or two later, I hadn't heard from Bob Stigwood in a few years, and I get a call from him one day. And he, we catch up pretty quickly, and how's it going and all that. And then he said, I'm involved with a band that I want to do a logo for, and I think you're the guy to do it. And that was the Bee Gees album. It was the main course album. I got a chance to work with him again, and I didn't meet any of the Bee Gees, but they really loved what I did, and that logo, and we did the main course album, and that was a big album for them in the disco world. That logo is still pretty synonymous. It's lettering that I designed just for them, in an alphabet that I didn't even really create the whole alphabet. It's just their name. And I've seen other people where they've taken and promoted a Bee Gees thing, and they'll do a takeoff on the lettering that I did for their logo. And it always seems to come up short. That happens a lot. Black Sabbath was another one that I did a logo for, the Sabbath Bloody Sabbath album, that today would be considered the ultimate heavy metal band logo. But back in the day, they took the album and the design and everything, and at the last minute changed it with a different logo. That's just that SS looking thing that was clunky and didn't have any reason for being on that cover. One of my best friends is Burton Cummings from the Guess Who. I did my first album for them in 1972 for Artificial Paradise. And we've been friends ever since, and I think I've done probably 7 or 8 albums for him. Black Oak Arkansas, I think I did 6. Alice Cooper 13. A lot of the bands would keep coming back to us. Some bands were one time and that was it. The Rolling Stones, they never used the same artist twice on any projects. They always go to somebody new, somebody different, somebody fresh. And so I was very lucky in that case to be able to do the logo. Went to Craig Braun to show him my work. I told you that I had this aggressive headhunter that was constantly putting me places to make the money because I came a show dog for him. He was the guy that would make it happen. And so I went to this interview, and Craig was just describing the whole situation and how I needed to take this record label graphic, which was a pair of lips, and go up to his art department and draw a tongue on the outside of it. He said, I think I could sell this to the Stones. So I did that. It took me about 15 or 20 minutes. He sold it to Marshall Chess, who sold it to the Stones, and I got a job and $200. I really love doing the lettering, and that's become, along with the concept and design, lettering has become something that's really been good for me. Pacific Ioneer, I did 189 album covers. And after Pacific Ioneer ended, that was in a 14 and a half year period. After Pacific Ioneer ended, I continued with other companies that I started, and I continued doing album covers. So along with a lot of the rock and roll stuff we were doing, there was also a period in the 80s when we started doing a lot of comedy albums. I mean, Cheech and Chong was done in the 70s, and then in the 80s, we hooked up with Little David Records, which was Flip Wilson and Monte K, and their big acts were obviously Flip Wilson and George Carlin, and The Committee, and Burns and Shriver, and comedy was like a pretty interesting part of what we did. It was kind of right in there with the rock and roll piece of it, but they too needed to have their album covers be more direct and more informative to their to the people that they were working or the people that they were appealing to, their fans. So when we started doing a lot of work for Little David Records, we started working with George, and we did I think 3 or 4 albums for George. He was a real character. So I was working, it was a Saturday, and I was working on some concepts, and the door, you know, knock on the door, and enters Drew Struzan, a kid who was right out of Art Center, and I had scheduled an appointment, and I forgot all about it. He was very persistent, so I scheduled an appointment with him, and I had forgotten about it, and he showed up, and I reluctantly started looking at his portfolio and was absolutely blown away. I mean, it was like looking at Michelangelo's portfolio. The guy was just insane. I hired him right there on the spot. And at the same time, I was talking about this Jefferson Airplane package that I was working on. And when Grace Flick saw the drawing that Drew had done, she fell in love with it. And so we did a variation of that for the cover for Baron von Tollbooth. So it was really kind of interesting. And then Drew and I worked together for about 3.5 years on staff. Before you know it, you know, the Pacific Ioneer Art Department became like a school, where we were all kind of teaching each other and learning, and it was great because I realized that the way I could be better at what I did was to be able to surround myself with people that were better than I was. And it forced me to be good because it was my idea and my assigning this guy or that gal to the cover that would make the difference. So I was kind of like a coach coaching all this talent, which was really, really great. So it, you know, it sort of taught me, I learned right along with them. So it was really kind of a learning environment, which was really pretty cool. So that's what Pacific Ioneer really was. Yeah, out of the 236 albums, it's sometimes really hard to remember all of them. And the ones you tend to remember are like The Doors and Alice Cooper. I've done 13 albums for Alice. Aerosmith. Black Sabbath. I'm sorry. Which one? Oh, yeah. Can we cut that piece out?